My name is Benoît Saint-André. I'm the Educational Services Director at Revolution Linux, and I'm here with Stéphane Graveur.
Okay, so I'm Stéphane Graveur, and I work as a TSP developer and Ubuntu agent for Revolution Linux.
So today we're going to make a small presentation for you about LTSP and graphics application. In short, the idea would be WETS LTSP, which is a terminal server Linux terminal server project, and what's the link between LTSP and the graphics meeting here? So we're gonna see very fast Revolution Linux, who are we and what we do, and the general thin client principle, what's LTSP and LTSP cluster, how do we use all your graphics application in education, and what's the problem with LTSP and the issues we have with various graphic applications. So first, just say Revolution Linux is a service provider, so we mainly do large-scale, open source, and free, liberate software integration into large-scale deployments, either education, universities, government, and private sector business too. So doing this, we integrate, develop, and contribute almost every bit of what we do directly into open source. And the living proof is Stéphane here, who is also Mode 2 in Ubuntu, so Master of the Universe. He's a core developer in Ubuntu and does maintain LTSP for Ubuntu and upstream, which is very important also. So we're going to present you our various slides. Next will be, what's a thin client?
Okay, so for those of you who don't really
just before you continue, just want to mention something, because we're not here this morning.
Yeah,
okay. We're recording the sessions.
Okay.
So the, yes, so you must be into that camera.
Okay, great.
So you remain within that space,
okay.
Please. Thank you. And here is the mic for the questions.
Okay, good.
So we record everything with this mic too.
Great. Okay. So yeah, for these of you who don't really know what we're talking about with thin clients, basically thin client is a computer without a drive, without anything. So you have servers somewhere and you just boot on the network and it just works. So it will boot a minimal system and then connect to a server for all the applications. It's basically the old terminal connected to a mainframe, but a bit fresher and with GNOME and everything, all the UI, server on a desktop.
One thing which is nice to say is often people think that thin clients are boxes, so hence the picture there. But really, we can see, and that's going to be important for the issues later, that thin client is really a way to access a whole environment. So we see a lot of buzz about virtual desktops and virtual desktop environment, and thin client is really a way to solve that, and we're going to see on the technology view how Linux permits that, and what are the problems having that.
Okay, so now that's some kind of standard LTSP setup. So what you usually get with LTSP, and not really with the LTSP we do at Revolution Linux, is that you have basically your network, then you have a server with two network cards, one plugged in the internet and the other on a thin client lab. That way works fine for, let's say, you have a classroom with 10, 20 computers, you have one server, and that works that way. Now, the main issue we had is that, okay, you have one classroom with 20 computers, but now you have 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 classrooms in the same school, and do you really want to put a server in each classroom and have to manage that? And that's for even only one school. In our case, we're working with school districts, where they have tens of schools, and some schools only have, let's say, 10 thin clients. So do you really want to manage one server for 10 clients? That's the regular setup you have with LTSP. That's what you get with distribution supporting LTSP. So that's Debian, Fedora, and Ubuntu mainly. So Modo2, that's the one with all the features.
One of the main problems that you see there is that, for example, you absolutely need to have a separate network.
Yeah.
Well, everybody has already built their network, and normally IT people don't want to create separate networks. They will do it for special projects. And the main problem with LTSP, with Linux Terminal Server Project, is that you want that to be spread out and to be deployed. And if you have to do a separate network each time that you do a new installation, well, your IT supporters won't support you anymore because it's a pita to maintain, to be politically correct. So there's been major evolutions. First, you've seen the little box that we showed, which is the ASUS E-box, but there's other boxes that are thin clients out there. So the hardware offer for thin clients improved a lot. Before, LTSP was a way to recycle old hardware. Well, now it's not, because if you do that, you end up with old machines that look crappy, and that can run crappily, if you wish. Because, the graphics card is poor, the interface doesn't look good, meaning the keyboards, the screen and everything. And people tend to say, well, LTSP is for old stuff. It's not something for me, because I don't want to use that old crappy thing. So in school districts and in the world, LTSP and thin clients have been a long time associated with cheap things, with something that I wouldn't want to work on myself, which is not the case now because you have the hardware that changed, meaning the arrival of Atom platform and with Intel graphics card and various supported 3D graphics card. And also, since 2000, well, the server hardware improved a lot, so you can buy these days servers that are bombs that can run off a lot of thin client sessions really fast. On the software side, well, we introduced Revolution Linux. We introduced LTSP cluster, which is open source and developed like all the software, all the open source software normally developed, which enables to cluster LTSP server. Meaning that it can offer a large pool of servers from which thousands of terminals of thin clients can boot on. So we have some clients in Laval, which is very near here, where they have almost 5,000 thin clients deployed from a central location, so directly in the schools. When a technician plugs in a thin client, he doesn't have anything to do, it just works. We don't have to reconfigure the network to change everything. It just works out of the box. What changed also in LTSP, thanks to Stefan and others, a lot of multimedia capacities were bring in LTSP. So traditionally, we thought, well, if you're a thin client, the sound doesn't work. You cannot put your USB key in. It won't work. So that's past. That was in 2001, 2002. Now those things work out of the box, and we can also offer remote access. So from home or from another computer, we can access the whole environment through something called NX. So no machine, no X. And the other thing which is important, because it's not the case elsewhere in the world, is that in Quebec and in some other parts of the world, in the United States too, in Europe, you have fiber optics between the school district central offices and the schools. In those cases, there's no need and there's no use to put a local server somewhere in the same place where the water pipes come in and where you have the air conditioning, and when the pipe bursts, well, your server is flooded. Well, if you go into schools, you're gonna see a lot of places like that. So now you can centralize everything so it can offer something which looks more, I'm gonna skip that, like this. So you can put your thin clients in the schools and have a cluster of servers connected to your other services centrally. So on an IT point of view, it's paradise because it's simple, it's in the rack, it's cooled, it's air-conditioned and everything. And on a client point of view, if you're a teacher or somebody in a school district, or even if you take that to a governmental point of view or enterprise, well, you just plug your thing, it's working, and it's supported from a central point of view. So you have best of both worlds. Now, problem is, we had problems with graphics application, and Stefan is going to explain you just what we had before. So
okay.
What was the traditional way of taking that?
Okay. So, yeah, as we said with the 10 client presentation just a bit before, standard 10 clients basically run everything on the server, and that's exported using the X11 protocol to the 10 client. That brings a lot of issue from graphic applications and 3D applications and things like that. So we'll discuss that a bit later. What we introduced as well is what we call local applications. So basically, you still don't have an Android, you still don't have anything on the ThinkCAD itself, but the image it is booting from the network contains some softwares, and these softwares can be run locally. So for example, we can now run Blender or some things like that. That we couldn't run through the network because it would just use all the bandwidth. So that's something we did to run some graphic applications or 3D or games or Skype or some other really CPU-expensive applications.
And the thing is, here, this idea of the thin client, which would, you have all sorts of vocabulary for that. People would think diskless workstations or a really thin client. Well, if you go in the Windows world or another world, often thin clients are not really what we call low-fat thin clients. They're really something that is installed on the machine. What we're talking about here is having really nothing installed on that thin client. Everything comes up from the network. And the big leap on that is the ability to run local applications, like we said, like Blender and everything. That could be run before. We've tested the Blender, for example, running without acceleration from the server, the thin client. It would work for 5, 6 in a classroom, 6 in another classroom.
Yeah.
But what we're talking about, what we're aiming at, is doing large-scale deployments. So that way, we started having, 1 or 2 years ago, a way to do large scale, to be able to maintain these, because you don't want to install and re-image 7, 8, or 10,000 desktops all the time. But at the same time, you would want to offer them specialized software like Blender and other things. So if we go on a technical point of view, this is really the way LTSP cluster work. Now, this may seem a bit overkill and technical. We're not in a network conference. We're really in a graphics application. Well, we present you all that because we're going to discuss issues with graphics application regarding the way we can deploy applications over a network. And this is really important that you understand those little points so that we can speak together afterwards.
So yeah, maybe the easiest is to take what a thin client does during its boot sequence. So basically, it does a DHCP request, gets an IP address, then gets the kernel and the INET ID from a TFTP server. At this point, it will be able to connect to a network hard drive that's using NVDE, then boot a minimal system, which will connect to the load balancer and the control center to get its configuration.
So that's different, because if you already installed LTSP before, you've seen that you put one server in a classroom or at home. Well, if you put a second server, you have to reconfigure all of your terminals to connect to that other server. What we introduced is a way to have a load balancer and something that can tell, well, this server is available, this server is less busy than the other, so that way we can boot thousands of thin clients from a cluster.
So at this point, it will know if it's connecting to a Linux application server or Windows application server, so we can basically support almost anything at this point. So let's say we connect to a Linux application server, so it will get an IP and connect using SSH, and then all applications will be sent remotely using the X11 protocol for display.
So the main idea here is that all your applications that you develop, GIMP or anything, are started on a local machine on a desktop with X11 protocol. But if you start talking about thin client, where there will be runoff from the user interface through X11 to the application server, and that's where the problems begin.
Exactly.
So I'm just going to do a quick leap on how it's used in schools so that we can discuss the issues afterwards. So in schools where, well, you're going to see that a lot of GIMP, Inkscape, Scribus, do we say Scribus or Scribus? I don't know. But Scribus are used a lot in classrooms. I'm talking about secondary levels, so high school, middle school, junior school, but also a lot in primary schools. And a way to enter the graphics suite is often using OpenOffice. So people, for example, will not use Inkscape at first. They will use OpenOffice Draw because it's simpler. It's a way to get used to vector graphics easier than Inkscape for a starter. And if we go further in the primary school, well, a lot of people will use TuxPaint to get a hand on really starting to draw those kind of things. Now, the main usage for that, and I'm going to speak about that tomorrow on the design issues in Two Software, is that first, all your graphics application are used to work on serious projects, which is not graphic arts. You know, graphic arts is not really serious. It's just for, it's a hobby. It's not, people don't do those kind of things, really. That's what teachers think about normally. So I'm talking about math, science, language, those kind of things. So the graphics is for other kind of people. I'm a bit silly here. It's just the way that it's perceived in the school, in the education industry. Other things would be to communicate, so really to do communication through graphics, so with schemas and a way to present things. To do really graphic production is a third way of doing that, so and not a lot of people will do that. So they will really want to connect on a thin client, start a software, and do basic things. And that's where we end up with people doing, for example, trying to do logos, or schemas using TuxPaint or using something to do drawings, which is kind of the easiest way to get that, but it's not the most efficient way. That would be Inkscape or using a vector graphics application. So it's really the problem that we're gonna end up with in the next slide are problems that prevent people from using the right software for the right task just because they are seeing performance problems. First disclaimer before we're gonna talk about the technical issues is that desktops don't scale. Because all the issues that we're gonna talk about, we were afraid that a lot of people will just say, well, stop using the clients then. Just use desktops. You're not gonna have those issues with that. Well, you know what? Desktops don't scale. Actually, if you go into schools, and into other kind of industries, education related, the main problem is that it's the only sector of the society where you don't have your own working tool. So you don't have your own computer. You have something like one computer for 5 or 10 students, and that is everywhere. In the United States, in Europe, in Canada, everywhere. So that's why we say desktop don't scale, because with budgets actually and the staff that we have that is not growing, well, desktop won't scale. We cannot provide one desktop to every person. That's why the thin client paradigm went in. It's easier to maintain, but it has some issues that we're gonna talk about with Stefan.
So yeah, so some point we have with the clients. Well, these are the points. So the first one is that the X server is remote. So any application doing a lot of X11 code and well, I don't know what some applications are doing actually, will just either kill the bandwidth or just be slow. We saw that sometimes with game, where you are drawing a line and well, you can stop drawing and you will continue to draw because yeah, it's just slow. That's one of the issues with using X11. Then we have the memory. Memory is really an issue because some softwares don't really do scaling well. Basically, they are sending like the complete picture to the in the memory and then doing the scaling using the video card. That's an issue when you only have let's say 20 megabytes of free RAM memory, because you just as it's remote, you don't have the application running locally. So if it would be locally, it would be using the RAM and it would be killed by the kernel. That would be fine, well, better than what we have, at least. In our case, as we are displaying the application remotely, it's the X that are using all the RAM. So it will be the one which is killed by the out-of-memory killer. So that's really an issue, and we are seeing that quite a lot in some deployments. The other is when you are doing local app, then the issue becomes the thin client memory. That's less of an issue because when you are not doing local app, you usually have, let's say, under 100 megabyte of RAM for the thin client. When we are doing local app, usually we have like 500 megabytes. So that's less of an issue. Then we have video driver issues. In some cases, the softwares are using XV for some rendering, and we have some thin clients that just can't do it or don't do it well. For example, we have some geode-based thin clients, and well, XV just doesn't work. And we are also using VIA, which is better as it does XV channel, but it only has one. So if your application doesn't correctly reset the channel when it kits, then you won't be able to start any other application using XV. So that's also an issue. And local applications are not always the solution to that problem, because we have a few thousand, 10 clients that just can't run local apps because they don't want to run a local application on geode clients that's 500 megahertz geode, but it means that starting Firefox will take like 2 minutes or so. It's not something you want to do on that kind of hardware.
So if we, there would be some ways to address those issues. For example, well, if local applications are not always a solution, well, you just have to buy bigger thin clients with more powerful CPU and more memory. Well, the problem is that way you won't be able to deploy more thin clients to offer more students the chance to use the applications, the open source application that we want them to use. So that's for one. The other problem is that we could use bigger machines or even recycled desktops. Well, we are starting here, and particularly in areas like California and places where we don't have hydroelectricity like Quebec, we're starting to have a power issue. Because when you use a big desktop, well, if you multiply the number of times that you're going to put desktops in classrooms, and you check that with the power you have left, and the money you have to pay the power, and just like the coal you're going to be burning to enable students to access technology, it doesn't make any sense. So that's why we have to find ways, and there are. For example, when we use some kind of thin clients that are based on the Intel Atom chipset and use the Intel graphics card, it's not a perfect solution, but you have native 3D acceleration and rendering with those cards. It's not perfect. It's not a way to have a 3D workstation to do animation movie, but it's a way to introduce students to the use of Blender. It's just because I see Martin here from the starter board. It's the same thing with GIMP and other applications. Well, it enables people to have access to technology and to touch it so that they can be able to use it afterwards and not to just like, don't use anything. And I'm not talking about the debate of using other software, like proprietary software, instead of this. It's just students don't have access to technology, though. So it's a way to see that. We had this.
Well, maybe it can explain a bit more, at least the remote X server point. So you have written client on the left, and you have the application server on the middle. So between these two, you usually have a few hundred kilometers and a few milliseconds latency. And most schools are connected using 100 megabit connection. So if you are using your application is X11 intensive, it can use 10, 20 megabit for itself, but you have 20 or 30 thin clients in the school. So that's usually an issue. And the reason why we say it's because X is remote is that we are using NX, and NX actually has some kind of minimal X server running on the application server. And with NX, you don't have the issue. So it's really, in this case, the only difference is that we have moved the X server to the application server, but doing so for all our 10 clients wouldn't work because you will lose all 3D capabilities and XV and any kind of acceleration because it's like improved VNC, it's not really X11.
So that's a main issue, and the idea with that is that we would like to have the opportunity of talking with some people from every graphics project here to see what are the things, and often these are small things that can be corrected or just be developed a way that it's going to be thin clients friendly. So there's way to have a fallback configuration of or a way of interacting with X11, for example, that would be less painful for thin client users. So we talked about GIMP, for example, when we do a line and the line takes a second to be drawn afterwards. So we don't really know for sure what's the problem there, but we're sure that together we could find solutions enabling more students to have the access for that. And let's not forget that we have the Revolution Linux logo on the words, but just underneath here. But it's not about us, it's about LTSP, which is used in all Linux distribution and all the way Linux thin clients are deployed anywhere in the world. You can think about Brazil, Paraná, where they have thousands and thousands. I think they have 20 or 30,000 thin clients deployed there. They're deploying some same thing in Guadalajara in España. They're doing the same thing in Macedonia too. So those kind of things really matter if we want open source to spread out and to be used a lot by everybody. So that's it. That's the one. So any questions? So we must have been clear.
No questions?
Good.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.